Welcome to Cleveland Heights Committee, the whole meeting. It's April 26, 2021. Our first agenda item is presentation discussion regarding garages. Planning Director Eric Zamp, please.
Everyone, I have a short presentation, so I'm going to share my screen. And let me know if you see that.
We see it.
Give it 1 second here. So as we know, parking can be challenging no matter what community that we're in. But particularly in Cleveland Heights, private parking garages present a unique challenge to the public, to the planning department, and to our boards and commissions. And that's because of our zoning code. Now I sent in the council's packet this week excerpts from the code, and hopefully you saw those highlighted areas. Everything related to garages, parking garages, it's all over the place. It's complicated. It's antiquated. In fact, it's not too much different than when it was first introduced in the 1955 code. It's inflexible and doesn't really have context to it, meaning different parts of the city are not treated differently when it comes to private parking garages. And it doesn't really meet the objective of what a private parking garage is, which is to allow for the appropriate amount of parking, but in a building that complements the primary residence. And so this has presented all sorts of types of barriers, and barriers to the investment that people want to make into their properties, improvement to their properties, especially when it comes to these private parking garages, sustainability and open space, because with regards to detached parking garages, they take up a big portion of our back and sometimes side yards that can probably be used better. And there's even an equity issue because, you know, not everybody has two cars that need to be in a garage. So how do we know it's an issue? It's not just, you know, something that the planning department's making up, or the mayor or the council is picking out of thin air, but it comes from a lot of activity at our boards and commissions. In fact, at the last 2 weeks at our April meetings, 30% of the cases at the ABR, at the BZA, and at the Planning Commission were related to garages. And not only that, but our department gets an equal amount, perhaps even more, of inquiries about that. And I'm sure you have gotten emails, and your friends or neighbors have inquired about it, how they can better use garages or parking on their sites. So what we'd like to do, and really the purpose for tonight, is just introduce you to some of the proposals that we'd like to make to then bring through a public process. And before getting to that, what we've done is we've looked at our neighbors. I know Councilman Unger always likes to ask that question. So we've looked at Shaker Heights and at University Heights, but also places like Independence and Columbus, and then some places outside of the state to see what best practices are. And that, and also the input that we've gotten from various boards so far, just on cases and the public, is we'd like to propose revising the definitions so that private parking is a bit clearer, provide more flexibility in terms of requiring enclosed parking spaces in detached parking garages, which is really what our code pushes you to do now. Provide flexibility in terms of allowing attached garages, which is where a lot of people are seeking to go, but it always involves a variance. Really focus on the design of the garages, which is the concern that I think most of us have by having supplemental regulations. And then also look at driveways, because in many cases, people can't get from their driveway into a garage because the driveways aren't wide enough. So provide some more flexibility there. And then empower the BZA to properly review garages, because right now they only can look at garage doors, at least according to the code. And lastly, just to mention, we separately, through our historic preservation design guidelines, are going to have guidelines that are related to garages. And those will be useful for Landmarks Commission and ABR as they review these garages. But first and foremost, it comes back to what does the zoning say and is it flexible enough? Does it meet the standards of today? So in short, I wanted to keep this really short. The process would be if we get the thumbs up from you tonight, then we would work closely with the law department to put it in the right format because our code has a very specific format for zoning amendments. Then present that at a future council meeting. Then it would be referred to the planning commission for their review and recommendation. Then there'd be a public hearing at council and potential action. We know that this is an important issue given how often it appears before us, but an issue that people are probably going to have a lot of different opinions on. So having the public weigh in on multiple occasions will be really important. And that's really a synopsis of where we're at. And hopefully, unless there's opposition, we would just look forward to working with law to bring that forward to you at a future meeting.
Hey, thank you. Is there any comments? Mary?
I was impressed by how many places and how redundant the garage legislation is that you highlighted for us. And I started to read it and then I decided not to because it's just so much. Yeah, we need to, that's ridiculous. We don't need so much every place. So yeah, go for it.
Thank you for doing this, Eric.
Thanks for the go ahead, and Bill and his team will be busy with us getting that into the right form for you.
Hey, great. Thank you. Good job. Okay, moving on. Presentation of CSU traffic stop data. Chief Mecklenburg, good evening.
Well, if I could say a few words before the chief's report, I would appreciate it.
Absolutely.
Okay. I wanted to provide some background information regarding the traffic stop data report. Just in way of a reminder, in 2020, our city contracted with Cleveland State University Division of Diversity, Inclusion, and Engagement to assist us in analysis and recommendations regarding our police department. We came to this contract because we wanted to go forward as a city, to be aware of what changes and protocols and procedures we needed to have examined and reviewed. The end result for us is a better police department for our community. Some of those initiatives that are part of the contract have been occurring during the last couple of weeks, and they have to do with use of force, bias-free policies, recruitment, and hiring policies. And we want these to be in line with state and national best practices. The second forum, which is on use of force, is tomorrow night at 7:30, and the community can access this on the website. So one of the initiatives that we asked Cleveland State to analyze was traffic ticketing patterns of the department based on whatever available data there was. That is the report that was recently received that is posted on our website and we are beginning to discuss tonight. When we as a staff received this report, we were of course disturbed and concerned regarding the racial disparity in traffic stops as shown by the data. Just like everyone else who has read it, we had a lot of questions and concerns. We really have to address and analyze the procedures to show what we can do to make things better. We will share our concerns, of course, with council, with the Public Safety and Health Committee, and with the soon to be implemented Racial Justice Task Force. And combined ideas, we will make whatever changes and protocols need to be put in place. One in particular that I want to mention is that the data doesn't show why the motorist was stopped. There's no correlation if it was speeding or running a red light. There's no correlation at all there. And that makes it very difficult. Our community of Cleveland Heights made a commitment long ago to support fair practices. This commitment has been passed down through generations of Cleveland Heightsers over the years. And I really could understand the reaction, and I can understand the reaction and concern and the questions regarding this report that we have been getting from our residents. Our commitment is and always has been to support fair practices in every part of our city government, and especially in our police department. I want to add that our Cleveland Heights Police Department, the men and the women, have made a commitment to protect and to serve. We appreciate them. We appreciate the hard work that they do. In studying and implementing and making changes in our protocol, these new initiatives will make our police department even better. That is the goal. And that is why we have contracted to have assistance for every element of our police department. And this contract has been supported, and information has been provided, whatever was asked for, and all of this under the auspices of our dedicated police chief, Annette Mecklenburg. She and I met this afternoon, and we both agreed that we really must do a due diligence to see what exactly we can put in place to ensure that the disparity is not there. And so that's really the pledge that I want to make to this community and to our city council, that fair practices are really the basis of this wonderful community. And we will go forward with analyzing and making recommendations regarding these initiatives. So now I would like Chief Mecklenburg to, she's going to pull out some of the elements of the report and that have, are key elements for us to look at.
Thank you, Susanna. And I would just like to begin by echoing your statements here, you know, our commitment here to transparency and the fair and equitable practices of the police department within here, the city of Cleveland Heights. So with that said, I'll give you a brief overview of the analysis performed by Dr. Dunn and his team at the Diversity Institute at Cleveland State University. As I get started, I just want to point out that this collection of race and gender data for traffic stops began in 2019, which was prior to us ever meeting or engaging with Cleveland State University. And one of the reasons that we started it is to take a look at our ticketing patterns and to be in compliance with the Ohio Collaborative, which is something that meant a lot to me, to show that we were having standardized practices along with other law enforcement agencies throughout the state of Ohio. And so it was important to gauge the different races and genders that we were stopping on our traffic stops. Prior to 2019, we've never recorded data for traffic stops, so we have nothing to compare this to. This was the first year that we even attempted such a measure. So in his report, Dr. Dunn talked about the city demographics, and in doing so, he based those on the 2020 census data. And according to his data here, the population of Cleveland Heights is 44,571. Of that, 50% of the residents are white, 41% are black, 5.3% are Asian, 2.8% are other races, 0.13% are Native Americans, and 2.8% are two or more races. Using that, he then looked at the data that we collected. And in 2019, the police department made a total of 11,237 traffic stops. Dr. Dunn used data from a 2010 study, which he conducted and used to look at other nearby cities and their ticketing patterns, which provided a measure of the driving population for many of the municipalities in Cuyahoga County, and including Cleveland Heights. This measure provided the benchmark used by Dr. Dunn to compare traffic ticketing data against and identify any racial ethnic disparities that might exist in traffic stop enforcement data. Based on the data that he used, the estimated driving population for the city of Cleveland Heights is 290,569 motorists daily. Of those, about 52% are white, 41% are black, and 9% fall into other races. Then when he looked at the traffic stops, of the 11,237 traffic stops, his analysis showed that 26% of those stopped were white, 66% were black, 2% were Asian, and 6% were other races or unknown race. Looking at the traffic stops, he also broke it down into those who were issued citations or just given a warning and no citation was issued. And the findings were very similar. Blacks were cited, they received 66.5% of the citations and 65% of the warnings. Whites, 27% were issued citation and 27% received verbal warnings. And then unknown races, 4% received citations and 6% received a warning. He also discusses a few other studies that he did and found that the Cleveland Heights Police Department faces essentially the same challenges as other law enforcement agencies across the country when it comes to diversifying in their ranks. And with this, he also looked at our structure of our police department. And at the time, which may have changed slightly, but not too much. The department currently has 95 officers, which is about where we're at now. 11.5% are female, 88.5% are male, 78% are white, 21% are black, and 1% are Asian. And again, as he had pointed out, we face the same challenges as other law enforcement agencies across the country when we talk about diversity in our membership. In his conclusions and recommendations, the findings of this analysis are consistent with those found in similar studies conducted in other jurisdictions in Cuyahoga County and other states and at the national level. But he noted that while there may be legally justifiable reasons that could help explain the racial disparities observed in the traffic stop patterns, due to the limitations posed by the absences of data on the specific type of traffic offenses, it's not possible to further probe and interrogate the data, which could offer plausible explanations for the observed disparities. So as Susanna stated, currently we don't here at the police department record what the citations are. So we don't know what the people are being stopped for, what traffic offense, and if they're issued a citation or warning, what it's for. We don't have that capability to record that data. But we believe, and he believes, that if we're able to show what the stops were for and what traffic offenses people are cited for, then perhaps we could have a clearer context, which would help to explain such disparities. I've spoken to the court and the judge and tried to get data that would assist in this regarding the types of citations. And unfortunately, their system didn't have an accurate accounting of the citations and the race of the person that was issued the citation. So we were unable to gather data from them either. More precise data will enable police management, city leaders, and the public to gain better insight into the reasons for and the type of encounters officers are having with the public, with which members of the public, and the frequency, necessity, and character of those interactions. The use of data in this manner is the hallmark of a learning organization, which is in essence an introspective, self-reflective, and correcting entity. Specifically, he noted that the police department should modify the data it collects on traffic stops to include the type of traffic offense. With that said, I have spoken to our court, specifically the judge, and they have taken measures starting this year to ensure that, you know, the race is recorded on everybody who has issued a traffic citation so that we can better gauge what citations are being issued. And I think that will better help us, give us an idea, an overall clearer picture of what's going on. And the only other type of ticket is the police department does issue a lot of warning tickets. Now, our warning tickets do not go through the court. Our warning tickets are for vehicle violations, equipment violations. That's where it's at. Equipment violations such as one headlight, a cracked windshield, no bumper, things that are wrong with the vehicle. In these citations, they come to us. The officer, they have 96 hours to get it fixed. They don't have to go to court. There's no points on their license and there's no fine involved. So that, unfortunately, with the court wouldn't be able to help us with that data. So that's something that we're going to have to look to track here. And I'm looking at a variety of ways and personnel who can help me collect and record that data so that we would have that available to you. So like I stated, I think this is a good starting point for us, but you know, we have some next steps that we need to do and to determine what else we can do and to get a clearer and more detailed picture of our police traffic stops, specifically the reason for and the types of encounters that we have with people on these traffic stops. So I think with the assistant city manager and others, you know, I am committed to looking into this further and finding out what else we can do. So that's a pretty much a brief summary of the overall analysis. And if you have any questions, I certainly will do my best to try to answer them.
Thank you, Chief. Do we have any questions at this time? Please raise your hand if you do. Mary.
I guess this is just a comment, but I would say, I think the solution to this problem nationally is not just police reform, although that's a part of it, because the best way to show that Black Lives Matter, in my opinion, would be to solve crimes. And so in order for that to happen, the African-American Black community needs to trust the police. And I think we need to be encouraging everybody in this community, but particularly African Americans, because I believe they've been denied opportunities to get the skills and move up. And so I would like to see that as a part of whatever we as a community do to address this issue. And it's sort of separate from the police. But I think it's important. So that's my comment.
Anyone else?
Excuse me. Yes, Jason, I just needed to respond really briefly to that. I want to make it clear what we are discussing right now in this meeting is not the behavior of Black people in Cleveland Heights. What we're discussing right now is a disparity in traffic stops that is borne out by data that has been collected and analyzed by the Diversity Center at CSU at our request. We are not right now discussing how Black people need to act. We're discussing what police officers do and who they pull over. I want to make it clear, I appreciate that this is also a large part of a larger discussion, Councilwoman Dunbar, but I need to very firmly express that we are not talking about putting responsibility on the backs of Black people right now. We're talking about our systems in policing, and we're talking about a disparity that we have detailed and that we are going to work on solving. I just need to make that clear. Thank you.
I would just like to say that I think we, I agree with the chief. We need more data about what people are being hauled over for and stopped. And then I think it will be easier to deal with the whole issue. But I agree we have to make police equitable and trusted.
Melody.
Yeah, I had a question that are most traffic stops, are those done by the basic patrol officers?
Overwhelmingly, the majority of them are done by the basic patrol officers, yes. Although our patrol officers also make traffic stops as well.
And is there any way in the data that you have, I'm guessing that the answer is no, but to see, like, is it, there are certain police officers that are more likely to pull over someone than others? Or there's probably no way to see that in the data, is there?
I'm not sure that that's possible. It's something I can look at. I mean, we can gauge an officer's activity out there. So yeah, it could be something that we could look at. But, you know, when it comes to basic, you know, patrol officers, that's their primary duty, you know, is traffic enforcement.
So they're all probably going to be fairly equal on that. But I just wondered if there was a way to see that. Okay, thank you.
Mike.
Very, very briefly, I agree with Khalil. This is about troubling data, not a bigger societal issue. I agree with our staff. You know, the data is obviously troubling. It's not what I would have guessed. The disparity is troubling. And I appreciate what our professional staff said in terms of their reaction, and I take them at their word that that they find it disturbing and that we're gonna search for it. Sounds like basically what we're gonna do is kind of what I call a root cause analysis to try to figure out what's driving those troubling data patterns, and that seems like a really smart thing to do. In my book, the one request that I would have putting on my, what am I, Craig, the vice, whatever, of the Public Safety and Health Committee now, and one of the folks who was in charge of putting our racial justice task force together, I'd like to make sure that there is plenty of crosstalk, because I see a huge amount of crossover between what the types of things that I anticipate. Obviously, it'll be up to them what they look at and how they look at it, but it seems to me this would be something that logically would appear right on their radar screen, probably fairly early on. At a minimum, I want to make sure there's equal transparency to us and to them in terms of the reporting, and then hopefully they'll engage on it. And I just, it seems to me to be a likely issue with a lot of crossover appeal, both with council and the task force. So, however that can be accomplished at the executive level, I'd like to see that happen. I know it's not together yet, so that's it's not something that I expect to see now, but when it's formed, I just want to make sure this kind of data is shared with them. Thank you.
Greg.
I think anyone that's been to Cleveland Heights Municipal Court, the statistics are pretty stark, and this study is even more shocking. I think we can't wait for our task force to come up with some ideas, some proposals. We need to start doing some things right now. And I'm going to hold a committee meeting next week to discuss the curfew, and we'll discuss this study and the takeaways from the town hall tomorrow. And hopefully we'll be able to come up in conjunction with the chief some concrete ways that we can start to address this now rather than wait for our task force to go through the process.
Great. Thank you, Craig. Does anyone else have a comment or question? Khalil.
Yeah, I had a few questions. I was wondering, I think actually maybe this question has sort of been asked and answered a bit, but I just wanted to make sure. What positions in the department are more likely to interact with the public? Is it the BPOs and the POs?
Yes.
Okay.
Those are all the officers who are on the road. Yeah. Detectives conduct investigations and follow-ups, but the contacts we have are with the uniformed officers.
And I had another question for you, and this is without any implication from this question about cause or history or anything like that. I just want to ask the question, and it's because I don't know the answer. I'm not sort of making a statement by this question, but our sergeants, lieutenants, and captains, were they all police officers first? When people are promoted, are you generally promoted from, say, sergeant to lieutenant, or are there other paths that are just as likely?
No, you have to first be, you have to be a member of the classified service. So you cannot be a BPO, you have to be a PO. You have to have done that for a few years and have that experience. Then you can test for the rank of sergeant, and then only sergeants can then test for the rank of lieutenant. Lieutenants can test for the rank of captain.
Okay. Okay, I noticed that, and as I said, without implication, it's just in the data, we have no Black men police officers currently. I don't imagine that has always been the case, but it's something, at least in the data here, that I wanted to note. It's difficult to have too many Black sergeants if you don't have any Black male police officers. And then, of course, moving up from there is even more difficult. I just wanted to point that out in the data. Another question about this data, talking about the warning versus citation data that we were looking at. And I didn't understand exactly the relation between whether or not someone is just as likely to get a warning as, you know, another person. So Black people are more likely to be pulled over in the first place. Some of the data is missing, so we don't necessarily have the full picture as to citation versus warning. But are, once pulled over, are Black people just as likely to receive a warning as white people or Asian people? I'm struggling to understand exactly what the statistical relationship is based on the write-up. Maybe with a little bit more work, I could figure it out myself. But if you have an understanding of that, I'd like to know. Or if we could ask Professor Dunn to clarify that for me, that would be helpful. I don't need an answer right now, I guess.
I can double check with him. I mean, and again, that's where, you know, I'm trying to interpret as best as everybody, just like, you know, you are with this. And I did speak with him briefly today to get clarification on some points, but of those that were just given a warning, and we're talking just a verbal warning, not one of our warning tickets, just a verbal warning. 66.5%, no, I'm sorry, 65% of the people who were given verbal warnings were Black, and 27% were white. So of the verbal warnings given, majority were given to Blacks.
Yeah, and that was the part that confused me a bit, because Black people were 66% of the people pulled over, or 60-some% of the people pulled over as well. So we can figure that out later. That's just maybe a detail that we can figure out.
Okay.
Okay, another question that I had about this, one of the recommendations was for the city to pass legislation specific to ensure, not just, I guess, policy from an administrative perspective, but legislation specifically says prohibiting the use of race, ethnic, gender, sexual orientation, identity, religious background, ability, veteran status, or any other socio-demographic characteristic as the primary or sole basis for a traffic stop slash citation. Now, I feel like we've already got something on the books that, you know, outlaws or prohibits police and other public officials from interfering with civil rights. That is something that we have on the books. Now, it's potentially a little vague, but I wanted to ask what kind of legislation specifically, if they talked with you about that, what kind of legislation were they talking about? Something more specific than that?
He did not give me any further indication regarding the legislation, but that is something I can follow up with him on. Okay. And let you know.
And if we, yeah, please do, that would be helpful, especially if he has any references or examples from other jurisdictions that we can take and modify for our purposes. Another question, are there organizations that we can work with to, as was mentioned in the study, to audit and analyze our, you know, leads data to try to find patterns, if there are any, in improper use of the what is the mobile data terminal or whatever it's called?
Correct.
Are there organizations that we can work with to audit that on a regular basis to see if they can see anything strange?
Actually, that was a kind of a new one on me, something I had never thought of and actually never heard of before I was analyzing the leads data. So to answer your question off the top of my head, no, I don't know of any organizations other than, you know, leads themselves. And, you know, that's run by the Highway Patrol. So that is something I can also look into to see. He obviously has heard about it or knows about it. So maybe it is something that the Highway Patrol does. I'm not sure, but I can look into that.
Okay. And I imagine we have to have plans to continue. I mean, you said we're going to continue looking at this data and figuring out how to record and store the data in a way that makes it more conducive to analysis in the future. What are the plans now for working on those processes and systems? How do we expect to connect our data systems to the court's data systems? They mentioned releasing data at least annually. I hope that it's much more frequent than that, but how do we do that with the least amount of time intensive, labor intensive work possible, you know, by creating the systems that talk to each other in advance so that we can just run a report maybe and throw it on the web for people to take a look at? What are the plans for that? What does council need to do to provide the resources to make that happen quickly?
Well, I mean, we don't interface with the court at all on their system, so we don't have that capability. That would be data that they would have to extract from their system and provide us. Again, we don't have a way currently on the warning tickets. They're not recorded. The data is not collected and recorded. So this is all something we have to look at. And you know, Dr. Dunn, he's the one who recommended the annually. He didn't recommend it any more often than that because he thought it was too much. He thought annually was sufficient to release the data. He also recommended possibly having a civilian a data entry person who could handle all the collection and recording of this data, which is, you know, something I don't have right now. You know, our data entry team is the last couple of years was cut in half. So I don't have the personnel for that.
When the chief and I met this afternoon, we talked about that very thing about filling some of the vacancies looking at equipment that was necessary, looking at the cost of that equipment. This is an important issue. It needs to be a priority. And so we will come back to you with some ideas and some recommendations that we have in order to strengthen that database. Because going into the future, it's going to be very important that we're able to look at it. But as the chief said, she needs her own IT entry person over there. And we need input from Jim Lambden and his IT team on what is doable both quickly and also financially. So that is a commitment we have made.
Thank you. I've got a couple other questions, but I also don't want to monopolize. If anybody else has any questions, we can, you know, continue to cycle through. No? Okay, I guess I'll keep going then. So let's see. Continuing this study, we know that the court does have data on sort of what the result of these interactions is. Do we have any plan to mine that data, request the data from the court, and, you know, either with CSU's help or some other entity, figure out sort of that piece of the puzzle that we're missing about whether or not this was a speeding ticket or, you know, failure to yield, or, you know, driving too close to someone, or not signaling when you change lanes, or turning into the far lane instead of turning into the closest lane, or something like that. Are we going to work on that?
Yeah, we're not going to be able to obtain that type of data from 2019 because they're just, it wasn't compiled. It isn't there. We wouldn't be able to get an accurate picture. You know, we had done this in 2020, and I had been in touch with the judge, and he's as committed as I am to this. So going forward, and probably starting with 2021, that is data we will be able to obtain. Okay. So it's something that we can do going forward, you know, between, you know, what our data is and his data is. We're also exploring the possibility, something we've been talking about for a while. There are, you know, financial costs and that associated with e-citations. Mm-hmm. That way you don't need to log it into the computer system as much. You know, everything is, the ticket is recorded in the car, in the computer system, and automatically goes to the court. So e-citations wouldn't mean the officer or the dispatcher has to manually input the data. It would be automatic, and that would help as well to get a better idea on the citations that are being issued. It won't help us with our warning tickets, but we're going to find another way to do that. But it would help us with our moving violations, your speeding, red light, stop signs, you know, failure to use a turn signal, OVIs, things like that.
Okay. And what do you think the estimated cost of that would be?
There are grants sometimes for the printers, but it's to buy the software packages and then the installation. It's several thousand probably. I'm not sure. I can probably have it at the meeting for you. I can have some estimated costs at the committee meeting if you'd like.
So I had an interesting conversation with a well-known civil rights attorney in the area recently. And one of the things that was mentioned in that conversation was we overregulate and we overcriminalize. Specifically, this person was talking about our speed limits. I know that we've had some conversation even recently about lowering speed limits on certain roads, like North Park. And there are, I think, some important reasons related to traffic fatality and the likelihood of serious injury at 35 miles per hour versus 25 miles per hour. But of note, I think, in this conversation was you know, like for instance, Coventry Road. Mm-hmm. I drive 25 on Coventry Road. I put my cruise control on at 25 on Coventry Road so that I don't respond emotionally to the people who are tailgating me trying to go 35 down Coventry Road, in part because I know that it's, you know, periodically there are police officers there who are very willing to pull you over for speeding, but additionally because it's the speed limit there. But not everybody knows it or recognizes it or is as cautious as I am. And so they, you know, people are pulled over frequently there. The complaint was that the speed limit is too low and it presents an opportunity for exactly the kind of disparity that we're seeing, because there is discretion in pulling people over. And it's a question, not even necessarily that a police officer is looking at a particular driver and saying, oh, that black person, I'm going to pull that person over because they're black. But as we've seen with preparations for Black Lives Matter marches, as compared to the January 6th event at the Capitol, preparation was different because the expectation was different. And they didn't even consider it consciously necessarily, but it's there. The threat assessment is wrong. And I think that that's something that happens with most of us in the society, and police are in this society as well. So when somebody's going 30 in the 25, depending on what they look like, you might pull them over because you're expecting something else. Now, my question is this: how often, you know, is it these arrests? How often does a traffic stop turn into a felony stop? You know, or how do we check to see whether or not people are pulling people over because they're expecting felony stops? Do you know what I'm talking about?
I would assume that you're referring to somebody has a felony warrant. Perhaps they have drugs or guns or something on them that would constitute a felony stop. Is that what you're referring to?
Yeah. I'm wondering that because some of the conversations that I've had with residents, you know, being pulled over, stories of being pulled over, being asked if they can look in the glove box or the trunk or, you know, looking in the back seat and that kind of thing, feeling investigated in a way that some other people might not, because, and from their perspective, it's because of the way they look. You know, those are the kinds of concerns that I keep hearing from people. You know, almost the desire to turn every traffic stop into a felony stop so that you can make something happen with that as opposed to just a citation. Is that something that we need to address?
Well, you know, most of the time when it comes to traffic stops, you know, and I, you know, have some experience with that, a lot of times you don't know who the driver is until you actually have them stopped. Especially if it's nighttime, it's dark out, weather conditions, they have tinted windows. You cannot make out the gender or the race of that driver until you've actually physically pulled them over and walked up to that window. So, you know, what they're stopping is the actual violation, you know, not the person driving the car. As far as looking at to see how many of these traffic stops have turned into actual felony arrests, I can check and see if that data can be extracted from our system. I don't know, you know, exactly how that would be accomplished. Again, we'd probably have to look at every traffic stop and see what the end result was. And that again is very time consuming, but it's something I can look into and see if it's possible.
Thank you. It is important to our residents that you look into that. I really appreciate your help.
I can do that.
As I said, I don't want to monopolize the conversation, so Melody, I see.
Yeah, I have a question. Yeah. So when the report came out, how did the rank and file react to the report?
I have not gotten any feedback from them yet.
Okay, they've gone over it. I assume you've gone over it with them in the similar detail.
I haven't had it for that long, so no. Oh. I have not had the opportunity to go over it into much detail. They're aware it's out there, and some of the higher ranking officers are reviewing it. and offering their opinions, but no, as far as anyone else, no, I haven't been able to talk to them in greater length about it.
Okay, thank you.
All right, I guess I've got a couple more questions. One of the things that I've been hearing as a possibility is converting how we do traffic enforcement and having a dedicated, not necessarily like OPATA trained, you know, carrying a weapon, sort of, you know, similar to the parking enforcement that we see in some places where it's not a police officer enforcing the parking laws or the parking limitations and putting tickets on people's cars. And I know that there is, you know, this is something that would have to be worked out and figured out, but is there any appetite whatsoever on the administration side in at least investigating the possibility of increasing non-police traffic citation work? If you know what I'm, have you heard of this?
I'm kind of following you, but not really. I'm trying to, are you talking about like parking enforcement?
Well, it would be, you know, if we're talking about, we've grown very accustomed to when somebody is going 30 and a 25, the person that pulls you over and issues you a ticket is a police officer who can, you know, arrest you, who has a weapon with them, so on and so forth. It has been posited that it does not have to be a police officer who pulls you over and issues you that citation initially. If it's a simple, you know, you were going 30 in a school zone, you know, and we need to let you know that and provide you a ticket to pay a fine. And it doesn't necessarily have to be a police officer under that scheme, that kind of thing. Is that something that you've heard of before?
I've heard of it in other states, yes.
Have you seen it working anywhere?
I heard that they were talking about implementing that. I don't know about it. Studies done or looking at on how effective it is. No.
Okay. Second question. Police enforce laws that, you know, legislators pass. And we've seen historical evidence that certain laws were definitely put in place, as in the purpose for putting the law in place by the people who designed it, later was revealed to be, not the purpose that was publicly expressed. And I'm specifically talking about drug laws and laws about marijuana in particular. But not exclusively. You know, there have been reports from government officials who put these laws into place in the 60s and 70s, who have revealed and confessed that they were expressly put in place to disrupt the anti-war movement and to disrupt the Black liberation movement in the 60s and 70s. So we criminalize things and then we enforce those laws. Does the police department or the administration have any particular objections to decriminalizing certain things? I know there was a rally recently on Coventry. Okay. I know that we can't decriminalize things for the state. They have to do that work themselves. But to the degree that we can, things like the curfew, things like even jaywalking, which can be used disproportionately, and we might see those things if we had the data. Can we have that conversation, or is there an opposition there?
I don't believe that there's an opposition, no. There are, I can think of one thing that, you know, I might consider that might want to be looked at as far as decriminalizing, you know, that law or ordinance that's on our books. Not all of them, but some. And if, you know, council would like to have that conversation, myself and, you know, some members of my staff, I'm sure, you know, we'd be more than happy to sit down and have it. Absolutely.
Thank you.
Okay. Melody, your hand was up a while ago. Did you still have a question?
Oh, I already asked my question. Thank you.
Oh, I'm sorry. Okay. Any final questions? Are we ready to move? Oh, Khalil. Okay.
Sorry. One more thing. This is something that I think I, at the very least, I'm not an expert in this. I'm not going to pretend to be, but a lot of talk has, you know, we've talked a lot about things like implicit bias training. And I think that it's important that we all, you know, us police officers, everybody, frankly, needs to look at the biases that we have. And whether we know about them immediately or consciously or not, we need to do some of that work in order to have a more just and equitable society. But implicit bias training hasn't been shown necessarily to be enough. What do they say? They say it changes minds, but not necessarily behavior. I know that we are working on implicit bias training, and that's something that I think we should be dedicated to. But I just needed to point out that that can't be enough if it's not effective. I don't necessarily have the answer right now, but I'd like to point that out and make sure that we are not doing ourselves a disservice by thinking that we can stop there. So that's.
No, and if I could comment on that, you know, I would tend to agree with you on that. You know, we had 8 hours of cultural competency and implicit bias training this year. With Dr. Dunn. Do I think that that's enough and we don't need to do it for another 2, 3, 4, 5 years? No, I don't. I think that we're always needing to do training. And that's one of the things that, you know, we are looking at here on a yearly basis. You know, training, number one, can be costly. Number two, we have to work it into our schedules and that, so it can't affect our manpower and that, but it is important. You know, we just finished another 8 hours of de-escalation techniques. We did some officer wellness training because it's important. If you want your officers to perform well, they need to be healthy as well. So that's something we're looking more closely at. No, this stuff is not going to stop with just one or two sessions. It's going to be an ongoing and continuous training. And I found it beneficial and useful, the training, but like you said, it's not a one and done deal. We're going to need to continue. And it's something I think, my personal opinion, since I'm speaking here today, it's not something that should be limited to police. I think other people, you know, government officials, city should also, we should consider that this type of training is provided on a more regular basis, because it really was some good training. And it really gave you some things to think about and some things to, you know, recognize about yourself. So I'm encouraged by it, and I plan on continuing to have more of those types of training.
Thank you, Chief. And I have one last question for the law director. In the report, they mentioned some concerns about Fourth Amendment violations. Now, they mentioned that with the caveat that there's certain data that we don't have, and so they're not expressing some sort of legal opinion or anything like that, but there is a mention of it, and we are going to be collecting more data. We are going to be releasing it publicly. We're going to be looking at this data, analyzing it, and making changes as we go forward. And I'd like to know, or at the very least introduce the topic, so that we can be aware of and proactively look at the possibility that if these disparities continue, what that would mean for us and Fourth Amendment violations.
So I don't have a, you know, an answer or a fully formed response to that question, but I see this as a part of a report that has a number of elements to it, discussed at some length here tonight, but probably also the tip of the iceberg. And the chief and I talk about these things with some regularity, not on a super frequent basis. And I have weekly meetings with the prosecutor to review some specific cases, but also what we're seeing generally. And we have been starting to talk about the Racial Justice Task Force And I think this ties into that, and I think it's going to be an evolving situation. I don't mean that to sound weaselly, but you know, it's an important issue. It's one that we're aware of, and I think there's a lot of work yet to be done, including within the law department, in supporting the efforts of other departments.
Thank you.
Okay. I actually, from the report, I was actually surprised that the recommendation to enact the legislation that specifically prohibits the use of race and the such. I would have thought that that was on the books already. I think Khalil kind of said that earlier, that he thought that it might be on the books or something similar. But if that's a recommendation, I can't imagine anyone on council opposing such legislation. So that one, I mean, as far as I'm concerned, you know, talk to Dr. Dunn. Let's get that legislation in front of us, and let's you know, check off one of the recommendations. Again, it should enact legislation. So I don't see any need to hold back on that. Second, Chief, you're talking about you know, being able to get the data that you may need, software. There may be grants out there, technology. Honestly, this is one of those situations where I would not want to wait for a grant. I know the police force is already underfunded. I've always I know that you make do with what council allocates, and I appreciate that. But this is one of those type of situations where we need to find the money to get this as soon as possible, within the next couple months, and get this in our police department's hands to begin documenting, so that going forward we have all the the information we need, so that when we have this next discussion, or the next council has this discussion, it's a much more thorough discussion. Because right now we have some numbers that are kind of eye popping, and I think we're all, you know, nervous and you know, what do these numbers mean? Because it doesn't look on the face like something good. It doesn't look like something that's Cleveland Heights. I think that's something we need to dig down. We need, you know, more specifics. Because I guess on the flip side, is that, you know, to equally apply the law is kind of what I'm looking for. You know, the law has to be applied equally. It has to be non-biased. If the numbers fall how they may, then that may be true. We just don't know that right now. And there's that question out there. So we need to resolve this and quickly, and address it if it is being biasly meted out. That's unacceptable. But, you know, for example, I get nervous when we start talking about the police aren't doing their jobs properly with traffic violations, because that's one of the major things that anyone on council hears about, is our residents hate it when their street is a cut through and people are speeding down their street and they have kids, you know, out in the neighborhood. And we get calls all the time, can you please get a police officer out here to periodically begin, you know, scanning and giving out tickets. So, you know, this is a quality of life issue. This is very important, and we need to make sure that it's being done, again, equitably, in the proper way, following the law appropriately. But at the same time, I don't want the police department to think that they should stop and just start letting, you know, traffic violations go through. That would be very detrimental to our neighborhoods. I don't know anybody that would want that. I mean, people are asking for more stop signs in their neighborhood, not less stop signs. They want traffic laws to be followed across the board, no question. And our police department should be properly adhering to that and enforcing the law appropriately. And if that is the case, and if that's what these numbers, once we get the data, show, then that's great. And if it's not the case, then that's where we need to make the changes. But we still need to continue to enforce our traffic codes.
I absolutely agree, and I think that's where knowing the different types of violations that we're citing and who's getting cited for what is going to help us determine that. Overwhelmingly, like you pointed out, speeding complaints and stop signs complaints, that's the biggest complaint I get from residents, and I get them on a weekly basis. They want the enforcement. They're complaining because the kids are out playing, especially with the nicer weather coming up. They want to see the police there. They want them to issue tickets. So we need to look at those speeding tickets and see if that's a factor and who's getting tickets there, or if it's another offense. But looking at the different offenses, I think will help us shed some light too. And hopefully give us a better idea what's going on and we can make the necessary changes.
Right. So again, please work with Susanna on finding, identifying the proper technology that you need, you know, whether, you know, getting the IT person in there to find the right technology. Let's spend the money, definitely apply for grants, but I don't want to wait. If it's going to take a few months and we can go ahead and make this purchase in a couple weeks, we should be making this purchase in a couple weeks.
We will definitely get an estimate on this, see what kind of money's involved, find out who can install in our cruisers. We'll definitely do that over the next couple of weeks. Absolutely.
Great. It's and then again, important. I just want to make it very clear. I'm not saying take it out of the police budget. I'm saying this is going to be taken out of council's general funds. We can find the money for this important issue.
Agreed.
Thank you.
Okay. Again, thank you, Chief.
Thank
Appreciate
you.
It. Looking forward to hearing more next week at Councilman Cobb's Public Health and Safety Committee meeting.
All right, great. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Okay, the next agenda item, which I have lost my agenda. Hold on. Okay, council organizational rules. Okay, which what I'm going to do is I'm hoping it's already 7:45, so it's starting to get late. We still have a executive session item. So I'm going to try to see if we can't move this along a little quicker. We already had conversation last week offline. I know a lot of individual council people have been talking about this, trying to understand more what the specific 7 points that proposed rules that Mike had submitted. And I know council person Russell, she's not able to be with us tonight because it's her birthday and she gets to celebrate her birthday. We all should be able to take the day off for our birthday. Melody.
Yes, she also had a friend that was in a car accident and died and is out of town.
Obviously that is definitely a reason to be able to miss a council meeting as well. But what I wanted to try to do is move the conversation along a little bit. Councilperson Russell had sent an email of her opinions so that council could know for tonight where she stands on the 7 rules. And I believe number 4 and 6 were the two that she had identified that she was not inclined to support, at least without clarification. So what I'm going to suggest is that just by a show of a thumbs up, if rule 1, 2, 3, 5, and 7 that councilperson Russell already says that she support or she's inclined to support, if you are, again, we're not voting, I'm just saying, I want to find out if there's at least 4 of us that are inclined to support that so that we can move on the discussion and our law director can, we can have a discussion with him to find out exactly what he needs to begin drafting legislation for next week. So, okay, Mary, you have your hand up.
I would like to say that I thought one thing that was perhaps missing from Mike's list was that, that there should be agendas. Invitations to committee meetings must include an agenda so that people know what's coming. And I feel that would be an enhancement to the suggestions.
Okay, so that'd be a number 8. Committee meetings must include an agenda.
I don't know if it gets included under one of the other bullet points but maybe it's a separate thing, yeah.
Well, I think that's a great suggestion. But if you don't mind, first, again, let's just stick to see if we can come to a consensus that we are inclined to move forward with 1, 2, 3, 5, and 7. Bill. You're on mute, Bill.
Thank you. I'm new to this. I didn't mean to cut you off. I apologize, but just with respect to the number of supporters that would be required if council is to take action on these items, it's 5, correct? Because we really would, because they are implicated in some of these rules, need to amend some of the provisions of Chapter 111. And so under the charter and Chapter 111, we would want 5 votes.
Thank you for clarifying that. So again, we're trying to see if there's at least 5 of us that are inclined to rule 1, 2, 3, 5, and 7. Again, just show up, you know, are you inclined?
Yes.
Okay, so we definitely have enough to move forward on 1, 2, 3, 5, and 7. Before we move on to discussing Mary's suggestion or number 4 and 6, Bill, what do you need from council to begin drafting at least those points? 1, 2, 3, 5, 7 for legislation.
Thank you, Mr. President. I would say that with respect to number 2, it's not entirely clear to me what if a council member disagrees with the president of council's agenda decision means, but it seems to me that it might be approached from a standpoint of adding things to an agenda or removing things from an agenda that's been previously put together and circulated by the president of council and the city manager. And so I would, if there is support for doing that, I would probably approach it that way and break out those two items. And I guess the other question I would have is whether, well, so the suggestion here is a 2/3 majority vote, which again is 5, rather than a simple majority. So just for council's consideration. So that's on number 2. If there's no objection, I would approach it that way.
I don't hearing any there is there many that are objected instead of just one.
I just have a quick question. I'm sorry, Mike.
Go ahead, Cleo. Go ahead.
Okay. I'm generally fine with drafting legislation and then sort of having a robust discussion around the legislation and sort of offering amendments to legislation and that kind of thing. That's how I would expect normally that a legislative body would operate. But this current situation is not going to be a discussion. We're just sort of testing the waters and then asking to draft, or we're actually having discussion or no?
As far as from my perspective, we discussed all these points already last week. We had kind of that, again, maybe not robust, but we had the discussions. I thought that there was clear majority that wanted to move forward with a piece of draft legislation. And that's what I was trying to find out, if there's still a majority of 5, as Bill said, inclined to support this and want it put in a draft piece so that Monday night we can go ahead and I don't expect it, not to be discussed. It would be discussed at that time more deeply. I don't see a need to go over those that are clearly not controversial from last week, at least for those 5 that don't feel it's controversial, to go ahead and move forward in those pieces that such as Mary just suggested a little add-on, and number 4 and number 6, where I'm not quite sure if the
Okay, I'm hoping that Jason can resolve that technical difficulty.
I see a hazard triangle on his square.
I'm assuming he's having some connectivity issues.
Yeah.
I don't know if he can turn off his video. If that would help. Of course, I don't know if he can hear us either.
I'll try texting him that.
Okay, can you hear me?
Yep.
Can you hear me?
We can hear you.
Yes, okay. All right, I'm sorry. So the entire thing that I had said before I went off, I guess nobody heard. But what I was saying is from my perspective, that if there was 5 inclined to move forward, we had already discussed it last week. So I thought we already had a majority that wanted to move forward with draft legislation. So we could discuss, you know, we could have more robust, or in other words, if anyone wanted to speak up at that time, opposed or in favor. But we already had the discussion last week from my perspective. So I don't have anything new to add to it. And based on, you know, that the at least 5 seem inclined to support it, I don't see anything new from my perspective to add in. So I just wanted to move this along and get to those parts that aren't, or at least I'm not sure if we have consensus on that one, which are 4, 5, 4, 6, and Mary's suggestion now, or any other suggestion that might come in. Did that answer the question? Okay, Mike.
It seems to me that Mary's good suggestion that there should be agendas for the committee meetings easily fits into 3. You can put a committee jurisdiction, including subjects, to be memorialized in formal agendas. I'm sure Bill will have no difficulty working it in there.
That I would not have difficulty working in, but I did have a question about number 3 if we're at that point.
If we get the consensus, can't you and I work? Well, okay. I just really get concerned that when we micro wordsmith this thing in a committee of the whole meeting, it degenerates quickly. But I'll do it. Like, I didn't, Bill, with all due respect, Bill, I didn't think there was a lot of daylight on what happened, how it would be that one might disagree with the council president about whether something is or isn't on the agenda. But we can talk about it. I'd prefer to get an expression of interest by 5 members of council, turn it over to your good office to put something together, and then we can talk about it. And if you have any questions along the way, I'm just one member who happened to be the original scrivener, which every time I do that, I remind myself, and I should remind my colleagues, it's a really bad idea. Don't do it, because it's just very frustrating. But I'm kidding to a certain extent. But Bill, we can talk offline. I mean, if on those that 5 people think it's a good idea, these are just sort of, to me, these are plain common sense things that you and I can talk about offline. But if everybody wants to go through it this way, we can do it. I'm
fine with my suggestion. I opened it up to you, Bill, if you needed, you know, any guidance. Typically, again, when council is inclined and there's clear consensus, then you draft legislation. I was just asking if you had any questions. I mean, I think you're fully capable of drafting that legislation, and then council can go ahead and pick it apart. I'm fine with that.
Right, although that's not a lot of fun either. But what I wanted to do was just to ensure that there was enough consensus that I understand what it is council's looking for, so that picking apart is fine. That's council's job. But we also want the rules to be clear enough that they're enforceable. And that's I'm trying to get something to you that is as fully developed as it can be. So just a couple more quick questions, if I might.
Yes.
And I understand Councilman Unger's point.
Yeah.
With regard to number 3, I just wanted to mention that committee jurisdiction, subjects, functions of council standing committee shall be determined by the president of council. That will implicate prior council legislation, including 13-2018 and 1-2020, which are resolutions by which you establish those standing committees and define their jurisdiction. So that can be done by council's vote, but I wanted to make that clear. And I will work on the next sentence, the disagreement with president of council's decision on that front. But there are some questions there, and I'll try to draft this in a way that any questions are either resolved or easily answered. 4, we are not addressing right now. Five, I can, I think.
Can I just interject one thing on four? Jason, I don't know who else spoke. I spoke to Davida. I think, and I think Melody can speak, who spoke to her as well. I think four is real easy to address. I was trying to say that it is limited to someone appearing in their official capacity, meaning at an official city event where the city is involved. So I think it's safe, frankly, based on what Davida said directly to me, to at least include it. You can take a hand vote, Jason, again, but I think you're going to have a consensus on that. And all we're doing is delaying things a little bit if we don't.
Melody?
If we don't do it. That's what she said to me anyway.
Yeah, I spoke with Davida as well, and her concern was she didn't want her events that she throws just as herself to be excluded, because she doesn't throw them as city events. She just throws them as her event. So that's what she was trying to get, is to make it clear that we're talking about city events, not individual council members doing things.
Okay, I just want to interject just very quickly. I'm under the impression that whenever the city has an event, all the council is invited anyways. I don't remember any other option in the past. So I have no problem with that. If you want to encode that, fine, encode it. But I think that's always been the way that we've behaved. So I'm fine with that. Is there five, you're inclined, okay with it? What do you say, Craig? Is that a no? Oh, you're fine with it? Okay, fine. So that Bill, number five. I'm sorry, number four.
So I think based on the prior discussion and this recent discussion, I believe I understand what council's looking for, so I can put that in legislation for council's consideration. And then we've got number seven, and this is the two sponsors essentially. I think I understand the purpose of this based upon the text and council's discussion at the last meeting. And then number eight, so to speak, is going to be folded into number three based on tonight's discussion.
Yes, okay. I think so. I don't, yeah. Okay. Yes.
Hey, Jason, quick question. Go ahead, Jim.
Yes.
So I think maybe going back to our conversation, Mike, is this still just for this year? Is this a sunset?
Yeah. I again, the precatory language that it was included in my communication to council didn't make it into the document that was included in the packet. But this is done on an emergency basis. It's in response to how we all, and it just to be clear, it applies to all of us with equal force and vigor, and it is intended to get us through this council session, which will end as of whenever, January 1st, and then it's up to the next count. The next council can renew it if the council likes it, then they can renew it. They can do whatever they want, but these are not intended to be permanent.
Did you catch that, Bill?
It's right in the beginning part of my email, Bill, when I proposed this.
Yeah, I understand. I'll try to make that work.
Okay, good. And back to number six. Is there, Mike, did you want to speak to number six?
You know, I talked to Davida about it. I don't, frankly, I didn't really understand the nature of her objection. This is de rigueur in the Roberts Rules of Order world. And there have been some issues where there's been some banter back and forth. And I thought it was important to ensure that if someone on council is accused of something by someone else, either directly or indirectly through cross-examination type questioning or something like that, that person is always going, just in fairness, that person is going to have the right to defend himself or herself. But in terms of decorum, it's the president's call as to whether that can happen. And none of this is intended as a criticism of you, Jason, because I think you've been very good in this regard. But say something comes up, and I don't know, you know, I mean, we're in that, some people refer to the campaign season as the silly season, right? And there's at least three, if not four, possibly four of us that are running for office this year. So you don't know what might happen on council in terms of things being said and accusations being made, et cetera. I just thought it was a good prophylactic measure to say, in the event that it happens, folks have a right to defend themselves if they feel that they're being attacked. The threshold determination to be made by our president of council. But if somebody doesn't like it and thinks they've been treated unfairly, I think you can raise the issue with the rest of council, and a supermajority of council can overrule the president of council. So hopefully this one, of all the rules, this one is the least often invoked, perhaps never invoked. And it comes right out of, I mean, I'm not sure everybody knows this, but this comes pretty much right out of Robert's Rules of Order. And I'm not an expert on Robert's Rules of Order, but the question of personal privilege is not something that I created out of thin air.
Just to clarify, I think in contrast to how we do it now, just so everybody sort of has the comparison, a point of order is generally, you know, you make a point of order when you are diverging from the proper order of business, or if there is some breach in decorum that you'd like to correct. And the way that we operate now, according to our current rules, if in a meeting, in a public meeting, let's say somebody is breaks decorum and somebody would like to make a point of order about that, they would say point of order, they would express what the point of order was about, and the council president determines currently on the point of order in the open meeting. So the council president does currently have the authority to make a determination on whether or not a point of order is upheld or not. Now, the one difference between our current practice under our current rules and this particular rule is that under our current rules, once the president makes a decision on that point of order, a majority of council, you know, the person who made the point of order can then appeal to the council for a different decision. And a majority of council can say, no, you know what, we agree with the person who raised the point of order. You have to have a majority in order to overrule the president. And the difference here is that you would need a supermajority in order to overrule the president, as opposed to a majority. So it provides the president with a greater degree of power over whether or not a point of order is upheld or denied.
Yeah, Mike.
Here's the problem with what Khalil just said. Everybody who's been on council knows that while he may have correctly cited the rule, what we have right now from an operational standpoint is what I call a blurt out situation. Just about anybody can say just about anything they want. And you can launch into, and we've seen this recently, and again, I'm not, anybody can try to back me in, but I'm not going to name names or give specifics here. But we've seen situations where, and I've done it a few times myself, by the way, where people are put on the defensive, okay, rightly or wrongly so. All of a sudden, you'd think they're a witness on the witness stand, and they're being cross-examined, and it can be pretty rapid fire, and the crosstalk can be pretty rampant, and nobody called for a point of personal privilege or a point of order or anything like that, because that's the way we basically run. We haven't been all that formalistic. All I'm saying is, and I've been okay with that, frankly. We have a whole bunch of rules that are honored in the breach more than they're in fact honored. But I submit that for the next 8 months, that ought not be the case. And if people are going to go after each other because they're being political, because they're running for office, because they view council as their opportunity to advance their candidacies, or they're just doing it because that's who they are, I think we should inject a little bit of law and order into this body and say, on that issue, if you're going after somebody for any reason at all, okay, and you might have very good reason to do it, you're going after a member of council, and you are calling into question their integrity or their motives or their character, that person has a right to defend himself or herself. But the president of council then gets involved in that skirmish, makes a determination as to how it's going to go. That initial determination will stand unless 2/3 of us disagree with him. I'm hopeful, again, that this is almost never invoked, but better to have the rule in place, and this time the rule in place and honored, than not having it in place. And again, it applies with equal force to everybody. It applies to the attacker, the attackee, and everything in between.
Did anyone want to?
Yeah, no, I wasn't disputing that. I think the only point that I was making is that the only difference from our current rules and this new rule is that the president has greater authority to determine these things, because an appeal of the president's position on a point of order is more difficult to come by with a 2/3 majority. That's all.
You know, this is not a hill to die on. If folks think that it should be a majority, I'm okay with that. And I'm okay. Several people have pointed out to me, you know, that it's likely that there will be redundancy. I suspect Bill Hanna is going to be telling me, Mike, what you proposed is redundant of something that's already there. Okay, that might very well be the case, but this is a reaffirmation by this council that these are the rules that we're going to live by. These will be the tool in Jason's toolbox as he tries to keep us organized and orderly during what's seemingly going to be a difficult election season. I think it's important.
Anyone else want to jump in? Mary, Craig, Melody? Okay, so not jumping in, I guess, then
the thumbs up.
Let's go with Khalil, you know, what he had said with just a simple majority versus a supermajority. Is everyone inclined? They're fine with that? Go ahead, put it in, majority. Mary, are you okay with that? Okay. Khalil?
Well, I mean, it's already the rule.
Right, exactly. Right. I don't disagree with that. Okay, so yeah, we definitely go ahead, Bill. You can write that one in then.
Will do.
Okay. Good. So Bill, is there any other questions for council regarding the seven rules?
One, does council want any additional language about the nature of the discussions that take place related to questions of decorum, such as indicating that inflammatory statements shouldn't be made, indicating that statements should be first or council people speaking should be first recognized by the chair and should only direct comments to each other after being recognized by the chair? Do you want to include that type of structure? I see no. Okay. I wanted to ask.
I'm a fan. I mean, that's already actually the rule too. Being recognized by the chair is technically under our rules because we operate using Robert's rules in the absence of other rules to the contrary. So what we would have to do in order to make it a situation where you don't have to wait to be recognized by the chair We'd have to proactively create a rule that says you don't have to wait to be recognized the chair, which to me seems like we're inviting interruption and chaos in a discussion.
And I agree with you about those concepts being embodied in Robert's rules. I guess it was sort of the honoring by the breach comment that led me to wonder if it makes sense to go ahead and emphasize a couple of these things, but they are embodied in Robert's rules. But they also appear in council rules in some places. So that was the reason for the question.
Just an FYI, for those that are going to be on the next council, I did go back and look. This was something that had been started, I don't know how long ago, 3 years ago. The Administrative Services Committee took a very, very deep dive on coming up with a set of rules. Mary Dunbar had her pen out and spent countless hours working on this. I thought she did a phenomenal job. I thought Carol Rowe did a phenomenal job. There may have been others. I know we used the Fort Collins, Colorado model as an example. There are literally hundreds of other rules out there and sub rules for running a council effectively and efficiently that make a ton of sense. But that wasn't what I was looking to do this time around. So I'm not knocking, Bill, that there are a bunch of other potential rules out there, but I think, you know, you can look at, you can, those that are watching Cleveland Heights City Council can be frustrated that we really don't follow Robert's rules. We kind of fumble and bumble our way through it, but I think in a very fair way, both under Jason and his predecessors, I think we plod through pretty effectively. So I just wanted to deal with each of these rules deals with a discrete issue that had been brought to my attention, either I had personally observed and discussed with others, or it had been brought to my attention by other members of council. That was what this was designed to do. It was not designed to be a comprehensive set of operating rules, and it is designed to be interim in nature. And I hope the next sitting council, working with an elected mayor, comes up with a really good set of operating guidelines and self-governance guidelines that and rules that work for them.
Again, Mary, Melody, Craig, anyone want to say interject, or should we just move on? If you're not interested, we'll just move on. Okay. All right. So we'll just that last point, then we'll just go ahead and we'll move on, Bill. Okay. Excellent. So that will then conclude our public session of the Committee of the Whole. We still do have a couple executive session topics. Can someone please make a motion based on what is on the Committee of the Whole agenda for executive session?
I move to go to executive session to consider the appointment of a public official and to discuss with an attorney for the public body claims or disputes involving the public body that are the subject of pending court action.
I will second.
Thank you. Mrs. Himmelein, please call the roll.
Aye.
Dunbar.
Aye.
Park.
Aye.
Russell. Russell is absent. Sarin.
Aye.
Stein.
Aye.
Unger.
Aye.
6 ayes, Your Honor.
Okay. For those that are watching us, you do not need to stay on. We're going to be in executive session for however long that takes. When we come out, all I'm going to do is adjourn the meeting. We're not going to be talking. So have a good night.
And we are back in regular session. You're on mute.
Man, I have got to stop putting that on mute. All right. Have a good night, everyone. Committee meeting is adjourned.
Good night.
Good night.
Good night.